Hello and welcome. I'm Chris Byrne, aka The Toy Guy, and co-host of the Playground Podcast. It's my pleasure and privilege to be your host and moderator for this POPTrio conversation today, part of the annual Toy and Game International Innovation Conference put on by People of Play. Today's conversation features three industry icons who you're going to want to hear from. Michele Litzky is the CEO and founder of Litzky Public Relations, now LPR. She's been named NJ Biz Icon. She is the past president of Women in Toys and a Wonder Woman. She's receiving the POP Life Achievement Award this year, and she's worked with almost everybody in the toy industry. Tom Kalinske is currently the executive chairman of Mixed Dimensions. He was inducted into the Toy Industry Hall of Fame in 1997. He's the former CEO of Leapfrog, Knowledge Universe, Sega, Matchbox, and Mattel, and he's known for building world-class brands and being a truly great guy. And finally, Jim Pressman, he joined the family business in 1971. He will be a Toy Industry Hall of Fame inductee in 2021, second generation after his father. Pressman is celebrating 100 years in 2022, and Jim is known for bringing the company into the 21st century and being somebody who has really inspired a lot of creativity and growth over his career. I know you're going to want to listen to what these three great people have to say, so sit back and enjoy. Well, I'm so pleased to welcome Michele and Jim and Tom, and we're going to be talking creativity for our POP trio. And I'm going to start by asking you guys a general question, because this is such a personal industry. So what were the things and who were the people that most inspired you as you were starting your careers? Michele, jump in.
I'll jump in. Well, one of those people is right here with us, Tom Kalinske. And I really have to say it's the people of the industry that have kept me engaged. It's having had the opportunity for decades to watch people pivot and to make changes and to be able to craft different stories to get their messages across. My inspirations, I was really fortunate to have a career that was bookended by two of the most inspirational people who were ever in this industry, two visionaries, Stephen Hassenfeld, the late Stephen Hassenfeld, and sadly, the late Brian Goldner. So for me, I launched brands for Stephen, like Transformers and My Little Pony, had the opportunity to nurture those brands and to build them. And then Brian Goldner made the stories even bigger and more relevant to a new generation. And I got to applaud them when they got to the big screen. So, and throughout my career, there have been, it's been one huge masterclass.
That's great. So Tom, how about, really, go ahead, sorry.
No, I'm going to say I've been very fortunate.
That's great. Tom, how about you?
I like that phrase, masterclass. Well, I started in the industry 50 years ago in 1971, and I was fortunate to get fairly close to both Ruth Handler and Elliot Handler, the founders of Mattel. And Ruth really was an inspiration in terms of she taught us so much about how to do the industry correctly, how to make a toy line correctly, how to build a brand. And Elliot, of course, was a creative genius. And Elliot would sit down, he'd come down to the lunchroom where we all sat, and here he is, he's the chairman of the company, and he'd pull out a napkin and he'd say, you know, I was thinking my grandkids like shopping baskets, and he'd start drawing on the napkin and he'd draw a shopping basket. And of course we made the tough, I took it to engineering and I said, Elliot says, do this shopping basket. So I was inspired by the two of them. They were a great combination. And then later on, of course, I was inspired by, oh gosh, so many people. Ray Wagner. I was so fortunate to hire Jill Barad. And Jill was probably the best marketing person I ever worked with. And so many others at Mattel. And then later at Matchbox, John Barber and Nick Austin. And then at Sega, my team of Al Nielsen and Ellen Beth Van Buskirk and Shinobu Toyota and the creative people that developed games. The process of developing games is very similar to developing toys. And everything comes down to, does it make a great story? And people may not realize it, but we storyboarded every single video game we ever worked on. Wow. Huge numbers of storyboards.
That's amazing. And Jim, you were kind of born into this business, but you were also from the class of 1971.
Right. Well, it's a smaller framework that I'm dealing with, but you know, my mother was my first inspiration. She was running the company for 15 years before she made me president. But when I first joined the company in 71, you know, I worked in the Brooklyn factory, learned the ropes there, and it was a fun time. Learning from the ground up for me was a wonderful experience. And then she hired someone by the name of Shelley Greenberg, who had a company called Shellcore. And he came in as a marketing guru. And he really gave me the confidence to believe that what I felt was the direction the company should go was indeed a good direction to go. And it was his motivation that got me going and became head of the sales in the company for a period of time when we lost a sales manager for good reasons. And it was an exciting time, you know, to build the company and for my mother to be there and to come into me and say, you know, I never thought that you could do this. I mean, you know, I was the younger of three. My brother was 6 years older. He was president for a period, but he always really loved the movie business.
Right.
And my mother, I was the least likely to succeed in this company. And, you know, lo and behold, things turned out well.
That's great. Well, I would call all three of you and myself actually a lifer in this business, right? So we basically spent our entire lives in it. What is it about this business that keeps people, that you can't quit it? What is it about this, the toy business that keeps people involved?
Well, I think we all hit on it a little bit. It's the people in the industry. I mean, the wonderful people in this industry, the great teams we get to work with, and it's all different types of people. I mean, the tooling engineers are far different than the guys in design or the sculptors or the marketing people. But yet we form a great team together and we end up loving these people. I mean, they're like family to me still all these years later.
Right. And you know, to that point, the buyers, the inventors, these people, all these different classes of people. And then there's the creative process that, you know, you're talking about, Tom, that is so fulfilling when you find something that really works and succeeds. And it's following that whole process from an idea to the consumer. It's thrilling. And the people, as you say, it's a wonderful place to be.
Third, what both of you have said about the people, my career, my chapter has certainly been blessed by many. But the other thing that really has kept me going is the our end user, and it's making things that for kids, you know. And you know, for me, fortunately, my world has expanded beyond toys over the past 40 years. And I've been able to take that same love of marketing to children the right way and taken it to publishing and taken it to food and taken it to fashion. You know, the kids aren't, you know, they don't have discretionary income. It's their parents. They have an allowance. And so for them to become engaged and to have their parents want to be able to give them what they're asking for. And Christopher always says, it may not be right for your child, but there is a toy that's right for your child. And I think we're really lucky that those are the people that we really are thinking about throughout the process.
Hey, Tom, your career has been sort of very corporate. You've worked with startups, you've done a lot of stuff, and you've mostly been a manager. And I'm really curious to hear, what is it that managers can do, especially in this environment, to inspire creativity in their companies? Because really we are a business that thrives on creativity. And how does the manager make that happen?
Well, I think you have to really listen to lots of people and encourage them and just keep encouraging them and encourage risk-taking. One of the fun things we did at Sega, we used to have the Golden Chicken Award. And the golden, it was a rubber chicken that I would hang over the office door or cubicle of the person who had the greatest idea that failed. And I'd also give them a $100 check. And so and I, the whole idea was, hey, it's not so bad to fail if you're failing for the right reason, if you're taking risks, if you're trying something new and different. And it made it just fun, you know, so people weren't afraid in the company to take outrageous risks and to suggest crazy ideas. And yes, maybe they didn't work out, but a lot of times they did work out. And then, of course, the reward was so much greater. And as Michele said, the end user is what we all cared about. And to get these responses from video game players that, gosh, that's the greatest video game I've ever seen. You know, crazy ideas. Whether we did a game called Toe Jam and Earl.
I remember that.
It was a funny, funny game. Now, who would have thought that would be a big success? But it was, and people still talk about it today. Toe Jam.
that's great. And I love the idea that failure is inherent in it, because in the toy industry, if 1 in 10 makes it, you're doing pretty good, really.
No, I was just going to say, when you hit 300, you go into the Hall of Fame. So, you know.
Exactly. Right. And I'm standing here with two Hall of Fame inductees, Tom, I think 1997, and yes. Jim, you're being inducted this year.
This year. Congrats.
Thank you.
A second generation Hall of Fame guy. So we're really thrilled with that. Michele, you and I have talked a lot about how raising a company, which you've done, is similar in many ways to raising a family. And I wonder, what is it about that mindset that's allowed you to create a company where people are engaged and excited and they never leave?
They never leave. Well, I grew up in a family business that is about as far from the toy industry in some ways as it could be. My family made paint for the government, so that when they were industrial paints and markers, so when they were marking ships, these were the paints that stayed on, you know, the writing stayed. But one of the things that really stuck with me was the fact that when the company did well, everybody did well. And so they also told me that health insurance was the most important thing you could give an employee. And so I felt like all of the employees were being treated like family and were being cared for equally. And that's really one of the mantras that I've spent the last 30 plus years with my own agency. I wanted to impart to them the same values that I learned growing up, that I saw every day in the business that my dad went to work for. And I think it's wonderful, and I'm proudest of the fact that I've passed those values onto a new onto more than one generation. And I'm watching the fruits of that labor every single day as they bring our tenets and our beliefs to the workplace. You know, work ethic is what I look for more than anything else. I believe that anything else can be taught. So values, the value system for me is what correlated.
And Jim, you took over a family company in 1971, as we said, and that was a time of huge transition in this industry. We were seeing the rise of corporate acquisitions. People, you know, Quaker Oats owned Fisher Price, CBS owned all these toy brands at the time. But there are still plenty of small companies today. What's the difference between working for a small company like Pressman always was and a big company? And why would somebody choose one over the other?
I think the advantages in this small company is that you can have a lot more impact on the company. There are less people. Ideas are critical. When you're working in a smaller company, the rise and the fall of the company is much closer. I mean, you do feel like a family. People who came to work at Pressman 20 years, 30 years, you know, the duration. And even when we ended up selling the business, the warmth that I received from the people who were not going to have a job, they were offered, you know, a job to move to Dallas, but no one took that up. But the warmth that I got from that was just irreplaceable. You know, you can't describe how warm that felt to me, that they appreciated everything that we had done all those years.
Tom, same question for you. You know, you've overseen a lot of big companies. Mattel, not a small company. Sega, not a small company. what can somebody who's a creative person find in a large company that they might not find in a small company? And what's your take on this?
Well, of course, one of the great things about a big company is we need a lot of great products. So, you know, as everybody on this call knows, about 80% of what we do every year has to be new. So there's a lot of opportunity for developing new products. So for creative people, it's a wonderful atmosphere to be in where you know the company needs what your ideas. They need your ideas. You got to have great ideas. And we've got to, as we were talking earlier, we've got to try to make sure those are fun things for children to play with and to develop them. So it's a wonderful atmosphere for getting stuff done. And particularly in this industry, that's one of the other things I love about this industry. We have to do so much every year. We just keep doing it. For a short period of time, I worked for Procter & Gamble. Their idea of new is we're going to change the label on Crest this month, and we won't change it again for 5 years. So, you know, this industry obviously is quite different from that, whether you're working on the Barbie brand or you're working on He-Man Masters of the Universe, or if you're working on something completely new that didn't exist before. Right. You know, as we were talking, the creative people have a wonderful chance to get their ideas accomplished, if you will, and then to see those ideas be loved by children and make children happy and make families happy. And that's what this industry is all about.
So you mentioned brands, and you've done a lot of toy brands, and we're not talking about toothpaste here and toothpaste labels. We're talking about, and as you said, I really want to stress 80% of the products are new. I think that's something people really should take away from this. That's unique to the toy industry. But you've built a lot of brands, and you've extended a lot of brands. What is the secret for building a brand in the toy industry? And there's really relatively few really true brands in this business. But how do you take something like a Barbie or a Hot Wheels and take them to the next level, or a Leapfrog and establish it?
Yeah, well, Barbie, when I went on the Barbie business, it was a $40 million business, and it had been declining rapidly from $100 million. Yeah. And Ruth Handler, I was working on preschool toys, and she came in my cubicle and said, "Tom, Barbie sales declined last year. The retailers say it's over for Barbie. Wall Street analysts say it's over for Barbie. My sales force says it's over for Barbie. What do you think of that?" I said, "Ruth, that's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. Barbie will be around long after you and I are gone." And she says, "That's what I wanted to hear. I'm going to get you on the Barbie business." And before she left my cubicle, I said, "Well, Ruth, what makes Barbie so special to you?" And she said, "Tom, with Barbie, a girl can be anything she wants to be." In other words, imagination. So if we're, you know, imagination is what makes great products. Obviously, children playing with a product that they can imagine being anything they want it to be, that's a great place to be. So with Barbie, it was capturing that idea, doing products that fit every segmentation of the market, whether it was for very young girls or older collectors or people who were interested in hairstyling or people who wanted to become a doctor, do Dr. Barbie or veterinarian Barbie or teacher Barbie. So it was just, you know, working on the imagination that's inherent in the product. And of course, the same thing was with He-Man and Masters of the Universe. It was a classic good versus evil story. Right. And as we mentioned earlier, everything comes down to the story. What's the great story you can have about the brand? And we built He-Man and Masters by doing a television, two television shows and, right. and a movie with Jimmy's brother.
My brother. The worlds collide.
It wasn't that great a movie, but the TV show was good. And then at Sega, Sonic the Hedgehog, we did two different television shows. And of course, the story of Sonic is a wonderful story, again, of a character who's kind of a smartass, but he always ends up doing the right thing. And so the children's imagination, or in that case, teenagers' imagination, can take that story much, much further. And that's what we do with great products.
You know, I think that commercial, and I may be wrong, I think it was like 1983, "We girls can do anything, right, Barbie?" And I could sing it for you, but I'll spare you, was a watershed moment for that brand. I mean, it really marked the cultural shift from Barbie as Malibu teenager to Barbie as kind of every girl's aspirational character. What about the cultural shifts we see, and how do you respond to them? Michele, you've been doing that a lot.
Well, I will confess that Barbie was my favorite favorite toy growing up, and probably she didn't inspire me to be an astronaut or a doctor, and I really don't think that publicist was one of the many options that she gave us way back when. But I think that's part of what makes this business exciting, is the movement and the shift and old things coming back and being new and trendy again. And it's our ability really to adapt to those changes. And sometimes you don't have to shift things in a big way, but I think that the one thing that always remains is to be authentic and to let the stories grow organically, you know. And my most recent example was COVID, you know, when all of us had to really think overnight about how to pivot our businesses and pivot everything that we do. And my pivot had to come after my client's pivot, because we had to make sure that everybody else was doing what they could do to stay ahead of things and to stay in front of things. And the one thing I saw and we encouraged was, if you don't have a place in this conversation, stay out of it. Wow. It's equally as important to know when to be vocal as when to be silent. And I think it's one of the things that I've loved in being able to counsel these incredible executives and say to them, not right this minute. Let's wait till the timing is better. And I think that's one of the things about these changes that you have to, you know, accept before. And some of them you got to recognize that they're not going to stay around.
Right.
I mean, did we ever really think, and I'm going to throw it to way back when, that, you know, TV, radio, magazines, and newspapers were going to be superseded by something called TikTok? Tom, I know you, and Jim, I know you both. Remember Caru and Peggy Charon?
Those were our
challenges, you know, and so now, you know, I'm delighted that I have a great team who's made that pivot. So I really don't have to worry that we're dotting the I's and crossing the T's. They do, because the landscape is so different and the conversation is so different. So I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, that's great. And yeah, I love the idea of brands as conversations. I've said brands are communities as well. And Jim, you built a huge community around a TV game show, which TV game shows, they were huge in the 60s. I mean, Concentration, Video Village, Seven Keys, all the ones. But you made Millionaire into a global sensation. Talk a little bit about the creative process behind that.
Well, you know, the game shows for us really started first with Wheel of Fortune. When I was in Philadelphia meeting a buyer at Lionel Legion, I remember being in his office and he said, there's a show called Wheel of Fortune. The ratings are really great. You should look into it. And at that point, Philadelphia is one of the few markets where the show had really exploded. And in the rest of the country, he was hardly even on the air. It was on at 9 o'clock in the morning, something like this. But I met with the licensing person, Jerry Kapner, and we put Wheel of Fortune together. And soon after, the show became a huge success. So after that, and the game was the number one bestseller in the country. And we actually had a guy named Bruce Whitehill who came up, internal guy, who actually came up with the concept of how to do Wheel of Fortune at home with a book so that you wouldn't know the answers and that the letters, we don't have Vanna White to turn the letters for you when you're home. So who else has to do it? But after that, we did Jeopardy and then we did others. And so when Millionaire came around, and started as a success in England first, we were known as a small company that can do great things and do it quickly, which we were very proud of, that, you know, we can turn things around. So Celador, who was the producer, virtually was sent to me from one of our friends in England who was doing the game in England. And he said to me, this show is gonna be a huge hit. There's no question about it. $250,000 advance, and right. It's yours. And I said, humana, humana, humana. And then I said, you know, he was very sincere. He was a wonderful guy. And I said, okay, you know, I believe you. And we sent our R&D person over to England to do the Q&A so that you had the different levels that you had to do. And it had to be all, you know, American questions. So there was a process there, but we did it, we got it out, and the size of the business doubled in 1 year just due, you know, to that one game. And we won the first Tony in 2000, which was an exciting moment.
Yes.
The toy of the year.
Totally
best license of the year as well. And those were wonderful times.
Yeah, I think that the other three of us were all there when you won the Tony, and you weren't that subdued for some reason. No,
it was now or never. We didn't get it then. And I've been replaying that moment for myself lately. We've been looking at some of the highlights of the company that's turning 100 years old next year. My father started it in 1922. And, you know, that was one of the highlights for sure.
I hope you kept a film of your performance at that Tony.
I have it.
Hey, Mr. Tony
people were kind enough to record that. And now I have it not only on DVD, but also on a JPEG or something. And
so great.
I have it in all formats.
And Tom Kalinske, I have a photograph of you from back in the day that you're lucky that I moved my office and it's still in a box of you. And Paul Rubens sitting in that big cherry when you came to Matchbox from Mattel and you expanded beyond little die-cast cars and we did the Real Model Collection of fashion dolls and we did Pee Wee Herman, which was unbelievable for Matchbox and gave us so many stories to tell. And I remember one of the stories that kind of backfired. And that was when we launched the Freddy Krueger, the talking Freddy Krueger doll. And one of your, oh yes, but listen.
You got $100.
One of the marketing executives who was working on the brand was being interviewed by Entertainment Tonight on a Friday afternoon. So there was really zero time to fix anything. And he decided to say that Freddy Krueger was the Mickey Mouse of the 90s.
Oh!
And then Tom had me sit for a week facing this executive, answering phone calls because the world erupted and people kept calling and saying, "We're not buying Matchbox toys anymore. We're boycotting Matchbox toys." So we wrote a statement, he and I, and I sat there on the phone because there was no Zoom. There was no way to see anybody. Conversations were between two people. And I had to sit there and say, we've all written those statements, but somebody shooting off a lip, you know, ended you and I in the middle of a little semi-crisis. It didn't end up in a bad place, but it taught me a lot.
Oh my God. One of my first memories of working with Michele was sitting on the floor of her apartment, putting sandwich boards on little figures, Pee Wee Herman figures that we mailed out to everybody saying Toy Fair is coming.
Toy Fair is coming, You know, what I really have been able to reflect upon and some of what I'm reflect on had a lot to do with Tom and Matchbox is that when I started out in the industry, which was the early 80s, nobody was publicizing a lot. And the first thing we all did was start to publicize Toy Fair. So you had all of these PR people. Most of us were not in-house. We mostly were hired talent. And everybody would send all of their invitations to the same 10 media outlets. The people at the New York Times would stop answering their phone. So if you didn't have a relationship, how were you going to get to them? And USA Today was the smartest. They started to do an article every year comparing all the invitations to Toy Fair. So we started to kind of raise the visibility of the industry as individuals and small companies and big companies. started to tell their stories. And so it was really fun to be at the forefront, certainly of that, and to now see how we communicate to make a big splash. Sometimes you got to make a lot of little splashes that are strategic and targeted to a very, you know, micro audience. So that's some more of my memories.
So I want to go back.
We sat on my floor and then schlepped hundreds of these little Pee Wee Hermans to the post office.
Right, exactly. It's a long way from pushing a button to send all days. So I want to go back to talking a little bit about creativity, because one of the questions I get all the time from people is, where do these ideas come from? Tom and Jim, you guys have launched some amazing ideas. Jim, I'm thinking of Gooey Louie. Tom, I'm thinking of obviously Leapfrog and all the other stuff that you did. Where do these ideas come from?
Well, I can start. And by the way, of course, at Mattel is quite different than Leapfrog. At Mattel, we had what we called a preliminary design group that came up with an awful lot of the ideas. They were basically inventors in-house, but we also used outside inventors. At Leapfrog, interestingly, most of the early ideas came from the founder of the company, Mike Wood. And Mike was very close to, he was a Stanford University graduate, and he was very close to professors at Stanford University in the School of Education. And he had a son who was having difficulty learning to read. And so he was working with these professors on what do I need to do to help my child, Maddie, learn to read. And the whole thing about phonics came up. One of the professors, Dr. Robert Calfee, said, well, you got to teach them the sounds that letters make. A says ah, but it also says A. C says C, but it also says K. And so that ended up becoming the first products that we did was the phonics desk and what we called the phonics traveler.
Right.
And literally the ideas came from Stanford University and Mike Wood. And so what Mike's philosophy was, well, here's what we have to do. Here's what the professors say we need to teach. Now let's figure out how to make it fun and interesting. And so that's what we would all focus on. And Mike was very good at trying to make things fun and interesting. And we had people inside who could make education fun and interesting and involving. Yeah. So anyway, that's short story.
And Jim, you have a great story about the game. I think it's called Ring Around the Nosy. Tell that story, because I think it's hilarious, the genesis of this game and how we evolve concepts.
Right. Well, I mean, just in general, I mean, games are a very, very, can be very, very personal thing. I mean, a lot of the best known games have come from individuals who never did another game in their life. Triominoes is a game that we had still in the line, you know, 40 years later, that came from a gentleman who made one great game and tried other things and nothing worked like that. On the other hand, there are great companies, Jeff Breslow out in California's group, the Chicago group, that are professionals. And most of the action games that we did during the years, like Ring Around the Nosy and Gooey Louie that you mentioned, came from these professional groups. But an amazing amount of games also just come from individual entrepreneurs who create companies sometimes, you know, out of one game. Bananagrams was one that's, you know, comes to mind, you know, but there are, you know, many. So Ring Around the Nosy that you mentioned, as I recall, because I was prepared when I talked to you before, but it's a German inventor, and the game itself was a mask that you put on with a long truncated nose, an elephant nose, and you're going down trying to get these donuts on the ground. So it's like bobbing for apples, but with this long nose that's an elephant. The German inventor originally had that game styled as an adult game piece, and one can only guess what he had in mind. But it was changed into a kid's game, which was a very successful game.
It was a very successful game.
Yes.
So, you know, one of the things I hear all the time is, can't we be more creative? Well, you know, I mean, yes and no, but what are the tools you guys have used over the time to foster creativity in your workers and develop your own creativity?
For me, I don't see these products, and we all know, because I was taught many moons ago, that product is king. So after these brilliant minds create their products, they get handed off to the people like me, who come up with advertising and who come up with public relations initiatives and campaigns. So my creativity, A, starts with the product, and B, reaches the end. I have to think about just not just the product, but the end user, and then figure out the story to tell and the matchmaker to put the two things together. But one of the things for me is I've always been a voracious reader, not just of books, which I love, but of magazines. And I'm not just talking about Forbes and Fortune and The New Yorker. I'm talking about magazines like TV Guide and People and 16 when it existed. Those were the things that enabled me to keep my pulse on what was happening with the end user. And what I found was, wow, I found Stephen Hassenfeld once challenged me to come up with an amazing invitation when we were doing something on Valentine's Day with Mary Lou Retton. And I'm thumbing through TV Guide, and I see this little tiny ad for heart-shaped balloons that pop out of a box. So I took one up to Hasbro and I slid open the box, and the balloon came out, and attached to the tail was the invite. And he thought I had sliced bread for the first time. I was finding something to watch at 8:30 on a Monday night back in the day. You can read Playbill. So I encourage everybody who works with me to be a voracious reader, to be a news junkie, to look at what other people are doing as your inspiration. You know, what resonates with you? You know, what impresses you? You know, what would I want my website to look like? I found others that I really respected and thought were great. So I'm happy to share in the creative development, because that's how I think it gets stronger. Ideas bouncing off of ideas.
Yeah, I'll jump in. One of the guys I worked for, Ray Wagner, who's also in the Toy Hall of Fame, was the CEO of Mattel and a former Sears buyer. He used to say, okay, when we're coming up with new ideas, do you really want this in your toy box? Do you want this in your children's toy box at home? There's only so much room in that toy box. Is this going to be something that replaces something else? And also he challenged us on the history of the toy industry to learn all about what had gone before us, you know, and what were the early products that people played with. Well, obviously it was stick dolls and blocks and things like that. Well, of course, block could become Legos. Stick dolls could become Barbie or large dolls or fashion dolls or what have you. Little green army men could become big army men.
And G.I. Joe. Yeah.
So, you know, Ray was great at challenging us on, is there room for this in your toy box? Do you want this in your child's home? I have six children, so it was easy for me. You know,
I want everything. Toy boxes at home.
A lot of room. but I think that's a good thing for people starting off in the business to do. Study the industry, study what's gone before, what's been successful, and think about how can I do that much better in today's world. So anyway.
I think the same way when we did board games, that we always said, if you stop after you played it once and you stop playing it, if you wanted to play it again, that meant you had something. Yes. And I'd say the other thing is that, you know, there were rules that people had about board games, and we broke the rules. And I would encourage people to break the rules,
to just
think out of the box. You know, examples of that were Gooey Louie. Before that, you know, taking snot out of a nose of a plastic head when you pick the wrong one and a brain pops out of his head, it seems so gross that no one would want it. Everybody loves it. And in fact, every major game company at the time, I don't know if Tom was around, he was probably in video at that point, but every major game company passed on it. And it was because we tested it with kids and not with parents in the room. And the kids loved it that we did it. And we saw the results that the kids really wanted. And another example was Hydro Strike, which when you played a two-player pinball game, and when one player got the ball in their goal and lost, they got sprayed with water. And I had to fly down to Bentonville to meet the Walmart buyer to explain to him that it was just a little spray, and the kids loved it. And he made us put a little burst on there that said, you know, slight spray of water, you know, not a big gush. And he bought the game, and it was a huge success. Another example of, you know, breaking some rules. You never have water in a house. It's only outdoors.
I think it's important to reinforce the breaking the rules. You know, you go back to the quintessential Nerf ball that broke the rule. You can't play ball in the house, you know, right. and all of those. So I want to know from each of you, what's the biggest risk you ever took and how did it turn out?
Mine is easy. I opened up a business. The okay. gentleman who was my first client, who said, take the files, is sitting right here with us. And you know, for the first few months, I was like numb. And then I realized Tom Kalinske is paying you to do X, Y, and Z. And it was enough of a fire that was lit. And here I am 33 years later, you know, bringing up another generation of rock stars, thanks to this gentleman who said, you can do this, do it for me. And he introduced me to John Barber. And, you know, it's kind of, I see my career in several chapters, if you will. My early chapter was my master class at Hasbro, whether it was Alan teaching me philanthropy, Neil Friedman showing me that you always do the right thing, Steve Schwartz telling me product is king. And then Tom Kalinske helped me start my next chapter, which is 33 plus years old. Except for the Pressman Toy Company, I think I've worked with almost everybody in the industry.
Get with it, Jimmy.
I was going to say Leapfrog, but I did do something for Leapfrog once. But, you know, it's because of people like Jim Pressman and Tom Kalinske that people and I are getting a life, people like someone like me is getting a Lifetime Achievement Award. You gave me the opportunity. I didn't want to be in the front. I was happy being behind the camera, happy being able to do your messaging and then watch all of you shine. So to be behind the scenes and to be honored for the work that I've done for most of on your behalf is heartwarming for me. All right.
Well, am I glad I encouraged you?
Right. Exactly.
I didn't realize I was that smart.
Thank you.
Tom, your biggest risk.
Oh gosh, I did so many.
I know, right?
I think the biggest risk was when I was lying on a beach in Hawaii with my family, and Hayao Nakayama, the chairman of Sega, tracked me down and appeared on the beach in his suit and said, you've got to come back to Japan and look at 16-bit video game technology with me and look at a color handheld LCD screen because you're going to love it and I want you to run the company. And I said, go away, you're blocking the sun. And one of my daughters, I think Ashley was probably 5 or 6 at the time, said, Daddy, he came all the way from Japan to find you. You've got to go back to Japan with him. And so I went back and I took on this job when Nintendo had 98% share of the market and was keeping everybody else out of the market. The retail buyers were terrified of Nintendo, that if they dared to carry Sega, Nintendo would stop shipping them. The game developers were terrified of Nintendo. If they should develop a game for Sega, then they wouldn't be able to do any more development for Nintendo. So it was a huge, huge risk. Risk of my own credibility, a risk financially, but I took it on. And in 3 years, we passed Nintendo in share of market.
That's okay. Jim, how about you? Where was your big risk?
Yes, you know, early on in the 19, after I became president in 77, Shelley Greenberg, and we were turning into a game company, and we built Triominos at that point. And then Mastermind became available. And we paid, I think at the time, we paid in 1980, $3 million to have the rights to Mastermind just for the US. And it was a big gamble, but it established us as a formative game company. And a year later, Rummy Cube came into the fold, and that was our triumvirate. And that build that we did that solidified the business is what was the backbone of the business for the next 40 years. And I guess right. The last big risk I took was selling the business. But that worked out very well as well.
That worked out very well. And I think it's really important for people to understand like a lot of Pressman's history, because in the 1950s, you guys pioneered doctor and nurse sets. And it was really under your stewardship that you transitioned into a full-time game company. You were more of a general toy novelty type of company, but you really took it forward with that focus.
No, that's very true. I mean, there was always a hint of, there's a checker game and a bingo game in the line, but at the point where I came into the company, they were heavily into preschool. And the reason why I felt that board games were a place to be was that in preschool, you're always building new molds every year. There's, like you said, 80% of the line has to be new. At least in the game area, you do have that foundation, which continues on family generation to generation. You know, Rummy Cube is as popular today, if not more popular than it was, you know, 45 years ago.
Wow.
So, but, you know, just to one point about the Toy Fair and PR, my mother, you know, bless her, when she was running the company, right after my father had passed, this is back in the 60s, she in the front of the toy building, you always had PR events going on and characters and going on. And one of her first moves was she was doing a memory game and she brought an elephant to the front of the toy building, which got a lot of press, you know, at the day. And the elephant never forgets. And that was one of her, you know, real moments that was great to recall.
I love seeing your mother in her hats, Jimmy.
Yes, her hats were iconic.
No, she was great. She wrote great parties. She was great stylish. You know, when she was running the business, she, Ruth Handler, and Alexandra Dahl, those are the only three, you know, women that had positions of leadership in the industry.
Yep.
And she ran that company.
Yeah, and I was recently had a flight canceled in the Milwaukee airport. And I watched as four people pulled out a Rummy Cube set and started to play right at the gate area.
No, we have great stories of, you know, grandmothers playing it, passing it on to the children. So, some people have put Rummy Cube tiles on their tombstone. That was, it just means so much to so many people. And doing COVID board games that been a boon for people to play at home. It's one of the ways that, you know, I think people have survived the whole period.
Your mom was truly an inspiration to me because of those very things that you're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, making noise and breaking through the clutter in front of the toy building. I once had a huge transformer change the time on the clock in front of the toy building, daylight savings time. An amazing photograph. That's so, great. You know, it's inspirations like your mother, Ruth Handler. I gave her the very first Witty Award. Tom Kalinske introduced her for me. Knowing that Barbie was my absolute favorite, to me, that was like meeting a rock star. Yeah. And it was one of the best evenings of my entire career was getting it to spend it with her. We sold her book. She autographed them. And when we ran out of books, she said, "They'll pay $10 for my signature on a napkin. Go grab some pink ones." And these were the women that inspired me. So it's incredible.
It's great.
That's great. So you've all had amazing hits, but you've also had things that didn't quite come up to expectations, to put it mildly. What were some of the things that might not have worked? And what did you learn about that going forward?
I have a really silly one. You know, as my career expanded and my agency got bigger and we started to work for more diverse companies, we did some work for Headstrom. And it was something that was golf related. And don't you know, I planned a fabulous event. I had never worked in the golf industry before. I worked in the toy industry. So I planned this fabulous event, and when no media wanted to come, I found out it was the British Open. on my event. So nobody who cared about got exactly. Whoops. The Hedstrom people were great about it. So I think it's A, check timing because it can blow up in your face. And B, the first question you ask anybody, particularly a reporter, is, am I getting you at a bad time? Because there's nothing worse than having to rush through a conversation with a reporter.
So, Tom, go ahead.
I've got a good one. You can't believe I was this dumb. Does anybody remember growing up Skipper?
Of course!
Yeah!
You kissed her arm.
Yeah.
And her breasts grew, and her neck got longer, and her waist got thinner. And this was to show how a young girl matured to some degree. Wasn't that a great idea? All of guys thought it was a great idea. The female buyers didn't think it was such a good idea, and neither did the girls that we were targeting to play with it. So it was a fairly big failure.
Yeah, but I remember it well.
Yeah. Jim?
We've had a number, but you know, the one thing that first comes to mind is that I think it was Ideal that they came out with the Jesus Christ doll.
I remember that. And
the biggest problem is when a product doesn't sell, it gets marked down. And now they had a warehouse full of Jesus Christ dolls that they had to close out. You know, that had to be a difficult situation. But you know, we had a game called Clown Around. You know, not on the scope of that, but it was supposed to be a fun game for kids with a nice clown. Kids are scared of clowns. A lot of kids are scared of clowns.
Right.
That one didn't work. We had another one called Rattler with a snake. And
snake.
The problem with it wasn't so much that it was a snake and it would jump at you if you lost, but the snake was hidden and it popped out. And so the action wasn't visual. And you couldn't make a good commercial, you know, out of something that's not visual. So, you know, you learn your lessons through that process.
So we're almost out of time, but I want to ask each of you, because you guys are really icons, people who I have just been so privileged to know and work with over the years. What would you tell somebody who is trying to enter the toy industry now? What one or two pieces of advice would you give to them? And Jim, I'm going to start with you.
I think have confidence in your belief. Don't go into it with the idea that you're going to make, you know, $1 million. Just go in with your passion. And follow your ideals. And I think, you know, that's true for this industry, true for any industry, that I think if you follow what you believe in and have confidence in what you believe in and have patience, that good things can happen.
Michele?
Listen and hear what other people have to say, learn from their experience and their expertise, but at the same time, use your voice, trust your gut, find your voice, find your place. How are you going to move the needle forward within the confines of the job that you have? But I think listening is key.
And Tom?
Yeah, well, Michele just said what I was going to say. So anyway, I'll second that one, but I'll add one other thing to it. And I think when you're first starting out, it's really important to understand play value. And Jim touched on it a minute ago, how it's not just, is it a good idea once? Is it a good idea for the child to play with over and over and over? And do they want to come back to it over and over and over again? And also I would say, when you're starting out, do more than is expected of you.
Great advice.
More than is expected of you.
Well, Michele Litzky, Jim Pressman, Tom Kalinske, thank you so much for sharing your knowledge,
thanks,
your expertise,
Chris.
And
thanks,
your perspective. And thanks to People of Play for allowing us to have this great conversation. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
Thanks,
very
Chris.
Much.
What a great conversation, right? It's not often that you get a chance to sit down with three people who've had such a profound impact on the toy industry over their long and storied careers. Thanks to People of Play for producing this. I'm Chris Byrne. Enjoy the rest of the programming.